hi, good afternoon. Thanks so much for waiting. Welcome to National Gallery Singapore if this is your first time. So this afternoon, we're so happy to have with us three art collectors from Southeast Asia. We have with us Pangrok Sulap from Borneo, Gudskul from Indonesia, as well as Brack from Singapore. And we also have Dr. Minna. She'll be moderating this panel. So this is how it's gonna work. We're gonna have the art collectives introduce themselves. So we will start with Gudskul, followed by Pangrok Sulap and Brack. And then Dr. Minna will facilitate a discussion on collaboration in art collectives. So without further ado, I will pass the time over to Gudskul.
Okay, thank you. Hello everyone. My name is MG Pinigotono. I'm here also with Sela and also YUD, maybe outside there. Whenever I've been asked to explain what the Gudskul is, I have to start it to explain the word nongkrong. Nongkrong is hangout. You know, like when you have a spare time hanging out with your friends, talking, maybe drinking, smoking, just talking anything. Because on that moment, you feel free to absorb anything. And you also feel free to share anything. So it happens a lot with us at the beginning. So that's why this nongkrong very important for us. Also, when you're going to come to our place, you also feel that way too. And So if you see this timeline, Ruang Rupa is start in 2000, and then Serum is in 2006. I am one of Serum, and also Grafis Suara Huruhara is in 2012. And then in 2016, we decided going together because we also have the same issue. We have same, we say that our common enemy, it's rent budget. Ruang Rupa Serum have to put their budget for 1 year rent a house. So we come up with this idea, how about we rent together one place. We can make everything there and also rent it, and then we don't have to pay. So somebody else to pay. That's the idea. And then we move to the big warehouse. It's 6,000 square meter. We just use it 1,000, and the rest we rent it for festival, for exhibition. It's very tough moment. We have been 2 years there because it's also expensive for the places. We are very struggling, and after that we decided move to the smaller house, a smaller place. Before Gudang Sarin ecosystem, the name went 2016 as a platform from our three organization like Ruang Rupa, Serum, and Grafis Huruhara. And then in 2018 we also move and then change name a Gudskul. Maybe next slide. So when we are joined together in Gudang Sarina ecosystem. We have, after we solve the problem, we have a same enemy, is a bad budget rent, and then we have a collective concern, which is ecosystem. Because, for example, Ruang Rupa is already have their own workshop for writing, art writing, curators. It's already happened several years. And also Serum already focus in pedagogic project, getting involved with the teachers and the students, high school level. And Grafis Uruhara more into printmaking, production, exploring the medium and everything. So we also, there is also, we make a festival, like a mini concert, music, exhibition. Our concern is to fulfill our own ecosystem, like getting more audience to come to our place, and also make a partnership with us, organization, also institution from outside Jakarta. Then when we move to the this place, it's 1,200 square meter. We call it the Gudskul. Our focus now is how we sustain our knowledge. Because for years we divide, like we trying hard to solve our problem by many errors, let's say like a DIY, even in managing we also DIY, because most of us is not a linear education, not really doing. We are some of friends doing the managerial, but they are not really studying managerial. We are doing by mistake. But we figure it out. That's why this kind of experience, we think we need to spread more, so other collective can learn from us, and then also for us also, I think it's very important to have a place to look back, you know. So that's why we want to make this knowledge sustained by sharing it. So at Gudskul now we have a 1 year program for, it looks like an art school, but it's not really like an art school. Maybe it's more like a residency for 1 year. We open. We have a focus. Maybe the next slide, please. And we also have all of the program, and also the activity. Like you can see, there is a shop for the merchandising. Rurukit is focused for parents and kids. Here also there is a Kunil who coordinate the Rurukit there. And Rooks over there is our commercial a company. It's a company. Rural Radio is our radio. We have a market every month called Tumpah Ruah. It's about 200 seller coming. It's like a pop-up bazaar, you know, and it's quite quite so many people coming. And yeah, this is still going on in now in one place in Gudskul. Next, please. As you know, Jakarta is quite huge, and also traffic. There's also, we hope it's one of our solution to not moving around so many times. So it's like one place, so you can meet everyone. Yeah, this is flooding. That's why we came up with this one-year program. We have this we have 11 focus of a subject that we discuss. We have a focus about the collective practice intelligence, collective cultural discourse, art collective review, articulation and curation, spatial practice, intermedia, public relation, collective sustainability strategy, workshop, art laboratory, and the last is knowledge gardening. So those subjects that we discuss more with the participant. But then also we also have a short course. The short course is every 2 months. It's happened every 2 months. It's already the third batch right now. We have 24 classes for these 2 months. Every day is 5 classes happen. It's always at night, 7 to 9. Why we make this? Because we also want everyone in Gudskul can share the knowledge. That's why we made. And then, next slide, please. That's the one's always happening. This is the payment method. We are experimenting about this system, but those choices are being chosen. The third choice, the second, and also the first. Next, please. Yeah. Next, please. I think I want to speed up. Yeah, this is a short course, and then, no. Please, again. Also, we're going to have an art camp for the senior high school level. This is like a short residency. We also have, we call it a remedial. It's more long term, but for the senior high school level. Again, please. Oh, yeah. The side back. Yeah, this one. This one is now we also have 24 studio. So we invite architect, designer, painter, Joy to come. And stay there, so we can having more diverse people, and also can make a more diverse discussion. So this is what we do. I think everyone looking for this. So we using this kind of idea of collecting collective pot. It's like we call it lumbung. So we Maybe I leave it skip before, because at the beginning, serum is become a legal is not as association or of foundation. At serum, first time making themselves legal as a private company. But Ruang Rupa as a foundation. Grafis Urara, until now, they don't do any legal things. So, but after, in 2013, we decided, we also with Ruang Rupa, to make a company. Oh yeah, okay. Make a company together to make this lumbung or collective pot more visible. So make another one, we make. So we call it Rooks. So Rooks and Serum, it's the most income. So we put it into collective. This is like a diagram, so people can get the money. Yeah. And we have this majlis. Majlis is like a house meeting. It's every month we have this meeting. There is 30 until 40 people come in to have meeting. So every majlis we choose the leader. They can choose the theme of the next meeting, even a costume. So it's fun meeting actually, but it's very long. Sometimes we also make games and make the stretching with the song and everything before. And make a jokes, of course. But also we have divided the topic and we have a small group to discuss something and then make the decision with this majlis. Yeah, this is like one of the family photograph of Gudskul actually right now, but what I can say on those pictures, I only know them 80%. The rest is like a friend of friend. I don't know. But they are there and talk with us and discuss with us. I think that's it for now. I describe a good school. Thank you.
So I would like to ask you to hold on your questions in your mind. So we move on to Pangrok and then to Brack. So please hold on with your questions so we will have the Q&A in the end.
Hi everyone. So my name is Kim. I'm from Pangrok Sulap, so I'm here to represent Pangrok Sulap, and I will explain to you Pangrok Sulap is actually an art collective. So we are, now we have like all 13 members, and within the members we have not only specifically just doing wood carving, but we are a collective of friends as well who does different kinds of art like crafts and henna, things like this. So, and then before we focus on wood carving, we does this kind of work. Like it starts from a sketch. The idea of making it a collective starts from jokes as well, because we are friends that also just hang out and just jokes around and make this kind of things. and decide to make it more serious as an art collective. Yeah, so before wood carving, this is the medium that we use as stencil, mural, and street art. And also before we used the name Pangrok Sulap, we were V for volunteer, because the passion is for volunteering and to work with our own community, because we believe that we're not very influential and we're not big. People don't know us, so we didn't start big. So we start from our own community. We started really small. These are workshops that we do in rural areas with the school kids. And yep, these are among the things we share. And also, Pangrok Sulap has the idea of sharing knowledge as well. So that is why we always do workshops. And this is the first time that we also learn about wood carving. Pangrok Sulap influence is Taring Babi collective from Indonesia, but we learn from Taring Babi. It's a collective as well, marginal band. And because we are so keen to learn about wood carving, and then, yeah, this is the first time. And then after we got the knowledge from Taring Babi, we start to share the knowledge with others. This is the first big piece of Pangrok Sulap artwork in 2014. Yeah, so this one is a protest that we collaborate with some friends, activist friends, and in rural areas. We go to the village and learn more about the social issue, what's happening. And yeah, so at first they didn't do a lot of visual arts in their protests. So if you see, it's just like writings. So we think that it's like less attractive. And the point is that we want to bring the message from rural areas to outside, to the city, so people will know more. So when we did workshop with them, it became like this. Like from wood carving, it became more visual, and people got like more interested with it. And people take pictures when they go inside the village, and they share on social media. And then people in the city starts to acknowledge, like know what's happening. So we really like go there and do it with them, with the things that's really like a political and but volunteering at the same time and doing a positive things with the community. And yeah, these are some of the artworks. Yeah, so as you can see, our artworks is like very direct. There's a lot of just writings and just a direct message. And the these are more. And this is the first kind of like a first time when Pangrok Sulap go outside of the country to do more. So basically Sure. That is Berlin, Zurich. Okay. So basically the point of our collective is about sharing knowledge, and it's just what we are passionate about. When we first started, we didn't have any funding, and we also decide to not try and ask for funds from government, because we think that we are more flexible that way, so that we really can do what we are passionate about. And that is why we had no funding. So then we use our own money to start the collective. This like six people from the beginning. And then with our own money, we also get the support from our community. So they start to donate us. And then with this money, that is how we can grow. And from this as well, from the first project, we start to think that we do need to sustain this collective. We need to save up. So we decide to put 20% of every donation we have, or every artworks that we sell, or projects that we do, to a collective fund. So actually, all of us are not have a background of art. Like, we didn't really study art. I think only one member, Ila, she studied fine art, but some like studied mechanical engineering, management, and yeah, it's just about, it's just why I think we are kind of very flexible people. Yeah. And after Pangrok Sulap grew, it's also from help from a lot of people as well, how they expose us to outside, like how we start to go to Japan is from a friend from Japan as well, who were interested in what we are doing. And then also it became kind of networking. So like, we got inspired from a collective in Indonesia, and then we make a collective. And then in Japan, we're inspired with the collective that we did, then they make a collective. And then another collective is made in Swiss, because they were inspired by a collective in Japan. So it's a big DIY movement that's happening with the wood carving art medium. So it's actually just a medium that we use. And I think what's interesting about Pangrok Sulap is that we always get together with the community and really interact with community and make them involved with our printing technique, so that it just feels like it's theirs. Yeah. Yeah. So, yep, I think that's Pangrok Sulap.
Hi everybody. So Key and I are from Brack. So my name is Alicia, and actually it's really interesting to be included in this panel, because actually Brack is, I think, a little bit of an outlier, because we don't actually really consider ourselves a collective, but we are more of a platform, and in many ways we work a little bit like a network. And so this is actually a screen capture from our website. So just to give you an idea, initially when we started, our co-founder, Melanie, she's actually an editor and writer. So one of the starting points we were thinking of working together was through writing and having dialogue with artists. So the original concept of Brack was actually digital. So a lot of the ideas that we had was in a way conceptualized to exist in the digital space. So we did for a period of time in the first year especially, we experimented with Google Hangouts a lot. So we would do dialogues with artists and writers, sometimes group sessions, online, and that was actually quite interesting for us, but also posed a lot of practical problems. For example, bad Wi-Fi in so-and-so's space or country. So after experimenting with that for quite some time, now actually a lot of our dialogues happen in person. So like our writers would pair writers who are interested to meet with say an artist with a similar interest or research interest, and we would connect them, and they would have a dialogue which will be archived on our website. So that was pretty much the starting point. And I think one thing that we really resonated with was also this idea of sharing knowledge. So as we met more artists, and really as a volunteer run group, again similar, we don't actually necessarily apply for funding. So a lot of our funding actually usually comes through the artists that work with us. So they might come to us with an idea, and then we would co-produce or co-create the content. So these are just some of the examples of some of the artists that we worked with in the past. So we hosted a Italian art collective, Love Defense, and also a German artist, Suzanne Bosch, and Herman from Italy as well. So a lot of these artists that we were also interested in hosting were artists who were keen to share methodology through workshops. So we would, in a way also in the process introduce local artists to present workshops at the same time. So, for example, we also had Tan Biyun, who did a workshop together with Suzanne. So these are just some images from the interactions. Yeah, and of course, we were also experimenting as well with the way that some of these workshops would happen. So in some cases, we worked with, say, bars. We had pop-ups in bars where people be having a drink, but our workshop be happening. Like in this case, Love Difference was making ice cream, which was part of an artistic recipe that they were experimenting with, and they were giving out the recipes. Yeah, this was again like a artist sharing in a bar. Yeah, so I think for the last couple of years, we've also been experimenting with different forms of gathering in the way that we introduce the artists, or the way that we would conduct these workshops. So in our platform, we have this thing called community leads or artist leads, who are people who are interested to connect with like-minded people or introduce artists to us. So in Indonesia, one of our close collaborators is Ketemu Project Space. They're based in Bali. So we also did like a co-residency program with them. And this was one of the work in progress that we contributed to, called Main Mandala. So we also helped in the research and engagement with the local community there. Yeah, so one of the things we discovered for this particular project was that the community had weaving skills. So we were tapping into that and using this as a way to talk about the pollution that was in Lake Batu, where the community is based. Yeah, and then from there, the artists that we work with, they of course continue their work, and we try to support their activities as well. So a lot of times, I think the way that we work with the artists is also seeing ourselves as allies, and trying to learn from their methodology, but also to practice together with them. So this was also one of the experiments that we did with a local NGO called Marua. So this was a really interesting project, because it was an exhibition, but our writers also helped to contribute to the panels. And the concept was a freedom boat. So literally, this was a boat at the Marina South Pier, and we had the dialogue sessions there, talking about various issues on freedom of speech. And some of the artists on our platform, like Dan Wong, his illustrations was being exhibited. And we also had performance artists as well that we worked with. And yes, so more shots from some of the workshops that we conducted at Singapore Museum, who's been a good partner for the last few years before now they are obviously closed for renovation. Yeah, we also did a collaboration with Dr. J. Cole, who was the convener for this seminar in Bangkok, in Asia Center. So we also helped to co-produce the seminar and invite like participants to join the workshop. And we also participate in other kinds of networks. So Bamboo Curtain Studio is also a close collaborator, and they often invite our participants from BRAC to join them in some of their research. So this is one network that we are quite connected to, called Green Art Lab Alliance Asia. So it started in Art COP 21 in Europe, and this was in 2015, this was the inaugural Asia version. Yeah, and currently we have a new collaboration also with Aya Aya Project with one of our contributors, Ernest, who's at the back here. So it's an ecological project looking at ocean plastic waste. So in this case, we also work very collaboratively with artists to develop interesting programs and also activate their artwork. So he has this artwork which is in the form of a dining table, so which is something that we're really interested in as well. How do people convene and how do people basically participate in social spaces? So this was one of the activations in Raffles Place, just outside the MRT station, where we had people actually join us in a mini beach cleanup, where they picked out microplastics onto a dining plate. Yeah, so they are confronted with shore debris which were collected from our local beaches. Yes, and this is Key, so I'm gonna pass the baton on to her to share a little bit about how her own activations in this piece.
So this was a piece called Matter of Food, and what I was looking at was the role of microplastics in our food system. So probably many of you know that we consume about a credit card of microplastics every week. That's fun. I was really interested in what would happen if we had a meal on a table made of shore debris, and then talked a little bit about plastics, but in a way that could be interesting and fun rather than just sort of like a lecture. So this is just one of the ways that the table has been activated, but Ernest has brought it to many different spaces, and we've been looking at ways to help people engage with the topic more interactively. I think moving forward, so basically in BRAC, we have a very wide network of artists and writers and editors who have helped us create four publications over 4 years. So we also have a sort of digital publication where we compile essays or write essays and then compile them about some of the work that we're doing. So currently I am the editor-in-chief and Alicia is the artist lead, but we have like a really wide network of people, some of whom are in the room, who have been really key and really crucial to sustaining BRAC. Moving forward, what some of the things that we're looking at are the art of converging. So what does it mean to bring people around an object, like a table or a meal or a topic, and have them engage around it? And also, how might we engage with conflict constructively? So we're really interested in ideas of power and identity and equality, and how do we bring people together to talk about these issues in a way that is not superficial, right? How do we actually bring those conversations down to a level where they are both full of conflict and difference, but also constructive? So in the coming months, we're planning to look a little bit more at that. And I guess the last thing I'll say is that one of the modes of doing that that we've been playing with is collective visioning or collective imagination. So just now, before you all came in, we were running a session in that room over there with about 25 people who are blindfolded for about an hour and a half. So thank you for bearing with us, those who were there. And basically they did a collective world building exercise. So they sort of were blindfolded, and then they were asked to build a world together collectively, a utopian vision of the future together. And that was supported in a multi-sensory way with lots of sounds and different things like that. So we're very interested in how we might use processes of convergence to help people world build, to help people imagine, to help people vision together.
Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Eugene. For those who don't know me, I work as a curator at the National Gallery Singapore. Very well, warm welcome to this symposium. We started something in art in Asia. And it gives me great pleasure, actually, today to introduce Dr. Minna Valjakka, who's an adjunct professor in art history and Asian studies at the University of Helsinki. And she's currently a research fellow at the Asia Research Institute and at NUS, of course. So she has published extensively on artistic and creative practices in urban public spaces in East and Southeast Asian cities, and she adopts an interdisciplinary approach, bridging together art studies and urban studies. She also examines urban creativity as a response to distinctive trajectories of geopolitical circumstances, developments in arts and cultural policies, and translocal mediations. Dr. Minna has been very actively in collaborating with museums, including the National Gallery Singapore, which led to a collaboration between Dr. Minna as well as the National Gallery Singapore in a conference in October 2018. It was titled Shifting Undergrounds in East and Southeast Asia, Transformations and Declinations of Cultural Self-Expressions and Communities in Cityscape. I'm not sure if any one of you actually attended that conference last year in October. Great, thank you. It was a wonderful conference that explored cities as a fertile ground for experimental cultures and communities. And it also included a special film seminar at that time created by Suka and Ishan for the National Gallery Singapore. So collectivism as a way of working collaboratively in radical ways in Asia forms an important part of Dr. Minna's research into underground cultural practices. So please join me in welcoming Dr. Minna. Thank you.
Thank you, Eugene, for such a lovely and warm introduction that makes me blush. So it's a great honor to be here today, and I have enjoyed every single moment with the three collectives and platforms and all the workshops that we've been doing. So my job today is thrilling but challenging. So I'm supposed to bring together a bit of a summary, what we've been speaking, and how you could perhaps understand better what's going on, what I call collectivism as cross-cultural reverberations. So as all the collectives already mentioned, and as been also brought forward by the previous speakers, Reiko-san and Kuroda-san, there's a lot of international connections going on. Already in the 50s and 60s, but I would say especially today, transnational reverberations going on between the collectives and platforms all around in Asia and in the region and also beyond it. So based on my ongoing research projects on urban creativity and socially engaged practices, my aim today is just to give you some of the key modalities and positionalities in relation to collectivism today. Those of you who are interested on in-depth academic discussion, I would like to invite you to pick up a hard copy of my forthcoming book chapter. So the book chapter is entitled, there we go, Cross-Cultural Collaboration, Modes of Participation for Co-creation of the Urban Public Space. So in case you are interested, pick up one when you are going. So in today's world, as we all know, there's a very strong wave of interest in arts and in its possible societal impact. Notions of participation, collaboration, empowerment, community building, and reinvigoration. And these words are the catchphrases that we are all familiar with. So how do we actually start deciphering what they mean? So if we think about the three representatives we have here today, what I think they all share in common in practice is the strong focus on experimental artistic practices, experimental education and knowledge sharing, and also the societal transformation. So how do we understand and contextualize these in relation to the society around us? So as we all know, the socio-political circumstances have been very much defining factor to all the art collectives throughout the history. That's something that we cannot ignore when we try to understand what's going on. But in today's world, as we all know, there's a lot of fuss about socially engaged art. During the recent two decades, it's become the term that everyone is talking about. And it changes how we do art and how we understand art and how we consume art in and outside of the art institutions. So, of course, this is a lovely opportunity to many of the artists, but please do not forget the instrumentalization, which is also happening at the same time. So, I think the collectivisms that we are facing today should be understood in this kind of contextualization. So, as said, today brings forward a lot of different challenges and contingencies to all of these art collectives around the world. So, of course, as everyone here mentioned, sustainability is a key issue. The second one is the partnerships. How do you form your partnerships, and whether you work with the local government or the national government or not? Then again, the question of multiple audiences, especially when we go outside of the art institutions, as all three of you are doing. What kind of audiences do we face? And then, of course, the artistic autonomy. How do you maintain what you want to do, and with whom? And of course, today, there is also the question of access to the transnational networks. Because without the transnational connectivities, you might not be able to do what you are doing today. And then, of course, the question of professionalism or the entrepreneurship. Because today's world, as an art collective, you also have to make a name for yourself. So different collectives, of course, have different takes on all these issues. So for example, the sustainability, whether you maintain your own space, whether you struggle with the rent, or whether you buy your own, or whether you prefer pop-up interventions like the street art collectives usually do. So as said, we spoke a lot about Wang Rupa already, so that could be mentioned as one of the key art collectives that everyone is familiar with, and how they have changed during the 20 years to reach the level where they are now. But as was also brought forward by MG, there's a lot of business orientation, if I may say so. Because you have to maintain yourself, how do you do it? So for some people, they start to be slightly critical whether Wang Rupa or Gudskul is a collective anymore. What do we understand as an art collective these days? So just to push you to think a little bit further, I wonder if anyone has heard about Team Lab. Yes, so it is established in 2001 as an interdisciplinary art collective of ultra-technologists. And it aims to explore a new relationship between humans and nature and between oneself and the world through art. Currently, they have more than 600 members hired on a monthly salary. So, they also have... Sorry. There we go. There's the information I was telling. So, today they have two museum spaces in Tokyo, quite huge ones, and a lot of people queuing to get in. Besides that, they have an office building with six floors, filled with these 600 members to work on it. So, according to my Japanese colleagues, this is not an art collective. It was established as a corporation to develop digital entertainment as Walt Disney. Whether it's art or not, I leave it to you to decide. But as said, I just want to push you to think a little bit further. What makes an art collective today? Is it the form of action? Is it the form of sustainability? Is it the general aesthetic aim? Is it the horizontal process of working together? How do we see it? So So my own book chapter that I've been working on relates to microgalleries. It's a transnational street art collaboration launched in 2013 in Hong Kong. I was lucky enough to be there to see the first interventions and document them. So since then, microgalleries have had initiatives also in Indonesia, Australia, South Africa, Austria, and Nepal. And they aim to help change the way we see the world, our environment, and our community, even for a micro moment. So they really go onto the street itself, and they blur the forms of fine art, street art, music, sound art, installations, you name it. But what was really interesting in 2013 was that it was not made as a participation art project. However, the people living in that area, that neighborhood, took the project to themselves. They started to take care of the installations, they started to explain to the visitors what's going on, and they started to watering the plants. So they started to participate and collaborate in the ways that was not preconceived. And this is led me to investigate of these questions of participation and collaboration in the urban public space, which makes it much more complicated than what we usually have in the galleries or in the museums. So as I said, I really enjoyed every single moment today with the shared agency you all gave us. But there was not really space to do something that I didn't want to or want to do, regardless of your guidelines. The only thing I could disobey was not to speak in the story making. So when we get into the urban public space, people might be destroying the works. They might be stealing them. They might be contributing new layers to them. So there's a lot of things happening that cannot be predicted and controlled. So that really leads us to the micro galleries in 2017, the big festival that took place in Jakarta. 50 different artists and art collectives from 20 different countries, different workshops, collaborations, and international support from different organizations and institutions. So this gets really messy in terms of participation and collaboration and what kind of audiences and expectations we actually have. So what I'm keen to broaden up is these horizons of and for participation and how we understand them. So Susan Lacy has originally made this diagram of the audience as a series of concentric circles with permeable membranes that allow continual movement back and forth. Some of you may know this circle and this diagram already. So I want to ask, what happens if we look collectivism beyond the collectives? What happens when we bring in the audience? And Susan Lacy's diagram is a good starting point for that. So I have taken the liberty to develop it further based on what I saw and learned with microgalleries during the past 5 years. So I still keep the original idea, like what makes the artwork happen in the project itself as the core of these circles. But then we get, besides the core organization, we get the main collaborators, volunteers, artists on site, off site, residents, immediate audience, media audience, and audience of myth and memory. They all contribute to this process of microgalleries in different levels. And people switch from one role to another, because there are a lot of things happening simultaneously at the same time. You might be an audience for one artwork, but also contributing to the next one. So when we think about the collaboration and participation, I try to decipher that through three main variables. mainly whether the work is done in situ, or whether it's pre-made, whether it's made in true collaboration or individually, or whether it is actually preconceived or just happening on the site itself. And all these different forms of collaboration and participation happen in public space all the time. So, as said, because of the time limitation, I can't really go in depth into these ideas that I have. I do ask you to take the book chapter with you and we can talk more. So for today's discussion, to think about participation and collaboration. So this intricate internal and external interrelations in the collectives, between the collectives and the audiences, needs further discussion. Also, these questions of anonymity and acknowledgement of individual agency or as a group. As said, you all need a name as a group. So, and this belief of societal change, which is not only possible, but essential. But how do we actually make it? And tactical knowledge production, which you all do. How do we teach the others to do the same? And this generative potential of collaborations, what we see, that's perhaps more a question to myself. How do I document, how do I prove that it's happening between you and the other collectives? And as said, this rhizomatic formation, a kind of imagined togetherness. I think that's the beauty of everything you are doing today. So thank you very much. I hope this provokes some questions, especially to the collectives themselves, what they do and how they find themselves in this world today. Thank you. Do we have another mic for the audience? Okay, then I'll just jump around. That's not a problem. So, anyone in the audience would like to ask from the collectives? Because I rather directly open the discussion to you. Yes, please.
Thank you all for sharing about the work that you do. I was just wondering if you could talk about your different relationships with the commercial art market and those relationships, like how you've seen the influence both ways, like how you might have influenced their tastes and values or vice versa.
Thank you very much. Which one of you wants to start? Okay.
Actually, we're not really into art market. maybe because also some reason. One reason is because we don't want to. Another reason because they don't want to buy it. You know, not all of the work of our in the ecosystem. Not really. Easy to collect, you know. So it's kind of hard also. But that's not really, because we're not really focused on that. How we sustain, we focus on make money from other things like making a festival, make a concert. That's a lot of money if we can make a good concert actually. And also how to make an exhibition and sometimes also artistic services for making make art as a commercial work. That's also.
Anyone else? No. Well, Pangrok Sulap is also more similar with what he just explained, because we're not really into, it's not the main focus, because we are more like working with community, and then our art is much more like just for exhibitions and yeah.
Have you mentioned that? That doesn't work. Okay, but you mentioned. Can you please check if it's really working? Yeah. Thanks.
But when we discussed earlier, you mentioned that one of the museums bought your work. So can you share what you deal with them, how you deal with the money at that circumstances?
Yeah, about the artwork that we bought, the money that we get from it, still 20% goes to our collective fund. This is to sustain the collective to keep on doing what we are doing. And then 80% will go to the people who are in the project at that time to make that big piece of artwork. So this is also kind of like a salary for the members, because we also need to sustain ourselves. So yeah, and also 10% is actually goes back to community. So we like help them to build, because we come from rural areas, from the village. So sometimes we think that if we have we are building like a crafts space for the villagers to work in, and also for them to like maybe make a collective as well. So it's like to provide them a medium. So we are helping with this, with the money that we get from the museum. Yeah.
I think it's difficult for us to comment, because I would say as a platform, we don't have physical products that can enter a commercial market. But we do, for example, like some of the artists who work with us, they might have artworks that they do sell. So I think maybe if your question is about how does our involvement sort of reshape that interaction with the galleries or museums, right? I think there is a little bit, because when we come in to say propose say a performance dialogue that changes the way people interact with the work, I think that also in a way changes the value of it. But very often, I mean, this is something that we've been thinking about as well. So now is kind of a interesting pivot in the way we're thinking of also creating our own works, which I think would in the future, you know, things might change for us as well. Yeah.